morning, and we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here in your house. Lord, as we gather together for worship, as we spend this week and the weeks to come focusing on what worship looks like, Lord, may we learn that we would worship you better, Lord, but that we would worship you in spirit and in truth, that you would be glorified not only in our lives and the things that we do, but that you would be glorified as we gather together as your people. Lord, be with this morning, be with our service, be with Jesse as he brings us your message, be with the worship team as they lead us in singing. Lord, be glorified. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Good morning. We are glad that you are here with us. There are some announcements in your bulletin. I will read through those with you for you. I want to encourage you to join us as you are able. And if you are unable to join us for these things, then be in prayer for those things as they take place. Breakfast fellowship happens the first and third Tuesday of the month. So this Tuesday, 8 o'clock at the log cabin. I encourage you to come out and have breakfast with us if you are able. The 21st of September, there's a Right to Life activity sponsored by Sauk County's Right to Life. That announcement is there in your bulletin taking place over at the Nazarene Church. We have a golf outing scheduled. That sounds like fun. October 3rd, if you know how to golf, you should come. If you don't know how to golf, we're going to be playing in such a way that you'll be playing with people who do know, and they won't make you feel bad. They'll actually help you. So you should come. It's going to be fun. We had an opportunity to golf with a handful of guys last week, and it was so much fun. We said we need to do this as a church. And so that announcement is there. Talk with Pastor Jesse, and we'll make sure that we have a spot reserved. Don't worry about the game. It'll be over. It won't start till we're done. Golfing October 3rd. The Life Chain on 10/3/21. That is there in your announcement. Weekly activities, again, Breakfast Tuesday. Wednesday, the Midweek Huddle is going to be small group oriented. And so the elementary kids, the middle school kids, the adults will all have their own classes. But come from 6 to 7 as we spend time digging into God's Word. An announcement that isn't in your bulletin. On the 26th, there's a membership class. Correct?
Next Sunday.
Correct. Next Sunday, there's a membership class. If you'd like to know what it means to be part of God's family, what it means to be part of our family here at New Life, and how those are the same and different at the same time, after church, come be part of our membership class. We'd love to share more about what the Lord is doing here at New Life. With that, let's pray again. Okay? Good. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for providing for us. Lord, thank you for your grace. Lord, we have so much more than we deserve, and that's because you give it to us. Lord, we have so much more than we need, and that's because you're a loving Father who desires to provide for us. Thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your Son that you offered that we might be able to have a relationship together. Lord, thank you for this time. May you be glorified as we worship you. Pray these things in your name. Amen. Let's sing again. If you would you please stand? We'll sing again together.
My distress, be
grabbing your seats, if you would grab your Bibles. Our scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Thessalonians. First Thessalonians chapter 5, we're going to read verses 12 through 28. If you're using the little black Bibles there in the pews for you, you can find that on page 837. If you are flipping through your Bibles, trying to find it, it is first off located in the table of contents at the beginning. That's the easiest way. Otherwise, all the T's live together. Thessalonians, Timothy's, Titus. So if you can find the T's, then you know you're in the right section. We're going to go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We're going to read verses 12 through 28. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. Make sure nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strives to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit, do not treat prophecies with contempt, but trust them all. Hold on to what is good, reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Brothers and sisters, pray for us. Greet all of God's people with a holy kiss. I charge you before the Lord and have this letter read to all the brothers and the sisters. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 12 through 28. At this point, our ushers are prepared to take up this morning's tithes and offerings.
To worship and song again, so if you would, if you can, please stand with us. Thank you.
There is one day.
for giving us things to be grateful for. We pray that you bless us with a grateful heart. Help us always to be looking for you, to you, for the blessings that you do give us instead of focusing on the things that are rough. And we pray this in your name. Amen. Please be seated.
I assume I'm on. We might need to turn it down just a hair for the important part. Are you guys thankful this morning?
Yes.
I hope so, because that is what the message is all about. You know, we just sang in the song, give thanks for what the Lord has done. Give thanks because he's given us Jesus Christ, his Son. Is there a better blessing than that? I saw someone shake their head no. I hope we don't think there's something better, because there really isn't. Eugene, if you could turn that top button just down a little bit so we don't have some of that feedback. Is there a better blessing than receiving Jesus as your Savior? There really isn't. Sometimes we want a different blessing. Sometimes we want a bigger house. Sometimes we want better salary. Sometimes we want more patience. And there's a whole slew of requests that we have. And we ask God, why don't you fulfill these? And if we're really honest, we say, why don't you fulfill these for me? Frankly, I like that song because it reminds us that God is thinking about me and he showed me his love and gave me his Son. And so today, as we're continuing through the series on worship, we're again asking, is worship more than singing time? Worship is singing time. Is worship more than the service from 10 to whatever time I say it's over? Of course it is, even though we call it the worship service. What is worship? Worship is when we spend time with God, when we're acknowledging his presence. Last week you asked, what does worship look like in my life? We talked about our family life, we talked about our work life, we talked about our friend life, and that there's all these different aspects. And we said, in whatever you do, we're to give glory to God, whether it's at home, whether it's at work, whether it's at friends, we're to honor him. That's what worship is. We're honoring, we're lifting up, we're saying, God, you are important to me, no matter where I'm at. And so we're going to continue that series today, talking about worship each day, every day, all day, no matter what kind of day it is. Are you guys having a good day today? Well, good. I hope it continues to be good. And with that in mind, I'm going to pray for a good day for us all, but not just a good day, but a better day, because we thank Jesus for it. Who he gave us. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we are thankful that you've given us life, you've given us hope, you've given us your love. Lord, you've given us a relationship with you through Jesus. And Lord, we don't say that lightly. We believe that is truth. We know that Jesus said he is the way, the truth, and the life. And that no one comes to you, Father, except through him. And you've given us that opportunity to know you and to walk with Jesus. And so, Lord, we pray that this morning, as we think about worship, as we think about making worshiping each day, every day, all day, you would help us to see how we can do that. Help us to see how we can elevate Christ, how we can pick him up, how we can honor him throughout each day. To be focused on him. Lord, that's what we want to do. As followers of Jesus, we want to reflect him. We want to become more like him. And we want other people to see him in our lives. So help us to do that better. Challenge us this morning with that truth. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this point in time, the children are dismissed to children's church. For those that are going, I want to encourage you, as you're following along, to use that handout that we provide each week. It's just a good way of knowing where we're at in the service. We'll be working our way through the message and the different points. Although I did have someone tell me yesterday, as I was doing a meeting online, they said, "How long do you actually preach for?" And they've never heard me preach. I said, "I'll let that one go." I want to say it differs, but maybe it doesn't. But this will help you pay attention as we're going through. Today, as we're thinking about how can I worship each day, every day, all day, regardless of what kind of day it is. How many of you had a bad day this week? Thank you for your honesty. I'm not going to ask you what made it a bad day. Sometimes there's things that we encounter throughout the day, and it's just frustrating. Sometimes there's news that we hear, and that makes it a bad day, whether it's news about ourselves or news about someone else. Sometimes it's problems that we're going through, tests or trials, and we're like, when is this going to end? So how do you make it through those days, each day, every day, all day, regardless of the kind of day, with a sense of worship, with a sense of putting God first, with a sense of giving thanks because he's given us his son? There's a lot that we get because of that. You know, I have a couple of different examples here. Sometimes we can be doing things and it's a great day. Maybe you've just bought a car and then you're driving over to your insurance person and along the way someone runs a red light and smashes into your brand new car. Before you get to the insurance place, that's not a good day anymore. You know, sometimes you're at a doctor's office and they give you news that you have a terminal illness. I've had that day. Yeah. Sometimes you find out, you go home and a spouse says, "I don't want to be with you anymore." That's a bad day. How do you get through those days with a sense of worship? These are the type of days that I'm talking about. Of course, there's other kinds of situations that you can think of in your mind that you've experienced. Sometimes your job says, "I'm sorry, we have to let you go." And there's not a thing you can do about that. How can I worship each day, every day, all day, no matter what kind of day it is? Now, we read quite a bit here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and there's a lot of good things here like respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord. That's a great passage right there. I'd encourage you to memorize that. Kidding. There's another passage here in verse 15. It says, or 14 and 15, it says, "We urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else." Great little tidbits along here. But what we're focusing on this morning is verses 16, 17, and 18. I want you guys to read this with me. It'll be up here on the screen. Verses 16, 17, and 18. "Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I'm just going to start out with the very last phrase there. For this is what? That's what God wants you to do. And people ask, what does God want me to do today with my life, the rest of my time here on earth? Let's just start here. Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. It is hard. Let's just be honest. This is not easy. But if we're going to be able to worship each day, every day, all day, this is where we start. This is what God desires of us. And as we're going through this point by point, let's just start with the first phrase, verse 16. Be joyful always. That's the fill in the blank. Be joyful always. It's hard. How can I be happy when I get this news? How can I be happy when something bad happens? How can I be happy with some turkeys around me that aren't doing nice things to me or to other people? I want to say there's a difference between being happy, this emotion, and having a deep down joy. It's different. That deep down joy is something that is the base of our life if we know Christ. It's something that our life is founded on if we know Christ. When he sang that song, give thanks because he's given us Jesus Christ, his son, it reminds us that, yeah, even in the midst of this frustrating time, I still have a joy that I'm holding on to. And it's Jesus. His love for me, my love for him, and by the way, it's his love for this other person that I'm really having a rough time with right now. It's his ability to look past a moment in time to a future hope that I have with God in eternity. This is that joy that we have. We've got to seek to be joyful always. If I'm going to live a life of worship, I need to have this joy in my soul, in my life, at the basis of my life. That's what joy is. It's more than a feeling. It's something that I know is inside of me. By the way, if you go back to Jesus' birth, there are some angels that came and notified the shepherds. One angel spoke to the shepherds. Do you remember what the angel said? I bring you good news of great joy. Even as Jesus was being born, joy was coming because of him. Not just a little joy. Great joy. Jesus brings joy to the world just from his birth. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. The angel was telling the shepherds that when this baby was born, Jesus, it was news of great joy. And by the way, was it just for the shepherds? It was for all people. It wasn't just for Jewish people. It wasn't just for the shepherds. It wasn't just for Mary and Joseph. It was for all people throughout history. He brings us joy. Literally bringing joy to people's lives, even from the time of his birth. So does that mean we shouldn't have joy in tough situations then? We're supposed to have joy all the time. Eugene, can you put up that James 1? Verses 1, or chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. This is a hard verse, too. There's a lot of hard verses in the Bible, by the way. We know that. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, when you face trials of many kinds. I asked, how many of you had a rough day last week? How many of you have had rough days throughout this past year? By the way, we're only halfway done with the year or so, three quarters. How many of you have had rough days in your life? Okay, this says we're supposed to consider it joy when you face trials of many kinds. I find it hard to be joyful during those trials. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. I would encourage you to keep reading through that process. Perseverance must finish its work in you so that you might be mature and complete in your faith. Sometimes in persevering through trials, we see, wow, God, I don't see the end, but I know you're here. Your presence is here. God, I don't see the end, and I want to know where the end is. So I don't want to wait for tomorrow, the next day, next year, whatever it is. But even in the midst of that, I know you're walking with me. You're giving me strength to make it through the day. You're helping me to step through. You're helping me to love this person, even though it's very hard to do. Consider it pure joy. Why? Because we have this joy that's deep-seated within us. It's easy to complain. Not that we ever do that. It's easy to be frustrated. It's easy to be sad. It's easy to be mad. And again, it's not that we can't do that. But God says, I want you to remember this deep-seated joy. Be joyful always, except when you go through trials. That's not what it says. Be joyful always. You know, we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, I don't know how often, but if you're a follower of Christ, you have the Holy Spirit in you. When you talk about the fruit of God's Spirit, it's what the Spirit wants to produce in us as we rely on the Spirit. Do you remember what the first fruit is? By the way, it's the next verse in your handout. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. Let's stop. God says, I want to give you the love I have for you so that you can share it with others. Love Him and love others. That's the two main things that we hear. These are the two most important commands. Love the Lord your heart with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Those are commands one and two, most important. You see that in the fruit of the Spirit is love. What's the second one? Joy. So I'm having a hard time loving people. Lord, give me your Spirit so that I can do what you're asking. I can't do it on my own. By the way, that's the same prayer for needing joy. Lord, I'm not very joyful right now. Frustrated, mad, sad, angry, all of these different things, impatient. I just need your joy right now. Not necessarily even to put a smile on my face. Just to get through and to be reminded that you're there. Help me to remember you at this time instead of just focusing on me. When we need to feel joy, we need to remember that if we're a follower of Christ, we do have joy right there for us in the Spirit. I want you to think about this question. Is there a trial or a test going on in your life right now where you need to feel joy? I mean, today, right now, as you came in or as you're going out, you say, boy, I'm not looking forward to having to deal with this. Is there a trial or test going on in my life now that I need to feel God's joy? I don't know if this is a trial or a test or a future thing. Today, Sherry and I and Josiah are driving up to Duluth, Minnesota. I don't know where he's going to go to college. Do you?
No.
Okay.
I wasn't sure if it was a college visit.
It is a college visit.
See, I don't know.
But I don't know where he's going. We got another one next Monday. When we took Solomon to campus, we got home, and Sherry, the next day, I'm sorry I'm talking about you. Sherry was shedding tears. That was his second year in college. I know there's going to be more tears shed next year when he goes away to college. Sometimes there's future problems we haven't even got to him yet, we think about. What issue, problem, trial, future thought do I have that said, Lord, give me joy about a son advancing in life? Maybe that's not your future issue. Maybe it's something else. When was the last time I asked God to release joy in my life, to say, Lord, I really need to feel your joy today? One so I can share it too, just, it's been rough. We have that joy right there. Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Spirit. It's that Spirit that releases his joy, his love, his peace into us. Number two, the next one is, I must pursue praying continually. Be joyful always, pray continually. Pray without ceasing. That's what I remember growing up, the versions that we use in church. Then pray without ceasing. Does that mean you have to be in church 7 days a week, 24/7, 24 hours a day? Dan, what do you think? I did put you on the spot. Do you come to church 24/7?
No.
Okay, can you pray 24/7? Okay. Do we have to be in church to pray?
No.
Absolutely not. Does it make it easier to pray while we're in church? Yes. Because we set aside things in life and we say, Lord, you're the focus right now. Sometimes we just need to set aside a moment during the day and say, Lord, right now, this problem is becoming the focus. And you're so much bigger than this problem that I think is a huge boulder sitting in front of me. Remind me of that. That's a part of praying continuously. Saying, Lord, right now something is blocking my vision from you. Help me to be focused on you. Praying continually means that all the time I at least am able to send a quick, short prayer. Lord, right now, I'm not supposed to say this, but I want to hit someone because I'm so angry. They've made me frustrated. They won't listen. Literally, I want to hit them with my car. That's the flesh talking, by the way. I don't know if any of you have had those thoughts, but sometimes that's what goes through my mind. Lord, help me to show your peace and to be kind to anyone and everyone else. That was verse 15, by the way. Praying continuously means that we can do it anytime. It's not us reflecting. It's not us meditating. It's just us saying, in the midst of the moment, even a thought, Lord, help me to keep my mouth quiet. Help me to show love right now. Because that's not what I want to show. Romans 12:12, it says this, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction. And what's the rest?
Faithful
in prayer. Say, Lord, right now I feel afflicted by this. My emotions feel afflicted, not because I'm in pain necessarily, but all of these things, Lord, and help me to keep my focus on you. I want you to think, is there a need I have or someone else I know that has that I need to bring up to God in prayer? Now, we kind of asked the same question earlier as far as God releasing joy, just to say, God, this is an issue. I just need to remember that you're in charge. I just need to remember that you're so much bigger than this. I just need to remember that there's such a greater hope that I have. I just need to remember that you're in the process of changing on. Change theirs, please. But also change me. Also change me. Be joyful always. Pray continually. If we want to worship each day, all day, every day, no matter what kind of day it is, this is what God desires for us. To be joyful always, to hold on to that joy we get from Christ that we can have released in our lives from the Spirit, to pray continually, to say, God, you are there even though my focus is not on you. Be joyful always, pray continually. What's the last phrase, verse 18? Give thanks only when you want to. Give thanks only when you are thankful. We wish that was the case, doesn't it? I'm not thankful about certain situations at all. Sometimes we wish certain things didn't happen. So how do we give thanks? She's not here. I heard someone say earlier that someone told them, this is a pastor in Reedsburg, it wasn't me. They said, you know, every day I wake up and I just say, thank you, God. And some of you heard that. Every day I wake up and I just say, thank you, God. Not thank you for this or thank you for that. I just say, thank you, God. This person said it really helped them in the future as they were dealing with other issues that came up, and it was significant, life-changing issues. Just to say, God, I'm thankful. And it said they helped them just to thank God for anything and everything they were going through, to say, Lord, I'm just looking for you. Thank you for a new day. Thank you for the sun. Thank you for Christ. To give thanks in all circumstances, no matter how hard or difficult they might be. To give thanks in all circumstances. The Amplified Bible puts it this way. Thank God in everything. No matter what the circumstances may be thankful and give thanks. Be thankful in all circumstances. All the time. We thought being joyful was hard. Be thankful even though someone's mean to me. Be thankful even though someone's mean to someone I really love a lot. And I care about. Be thankful when somebody says all kinds of words we disagree with. Be thankful in those situations too. Yep. How do we show worship each day, every day, all day? No matter what kind of day? To give thanks in all circumstances. Because no matter what we go through, God is there for us. Because no matter how weak we think we are, God's strength is there for us. Dave's been leading the Sunday school class. He's out there. That's where he is. And it's Facing Your Goliath. And he's looking at how David faced Goliath and applying that to our lives. And the question is, what are the Goliaths that you face? And sometimes those are the easiest to see. Right? The big problems that we face. And by the way, David and Goliath is one of my favorite stories in the Bible. It's 1 Samuel 17. And right, he was a short kid. In fact, when Samuel picked David as the king, Jesse, his father, brought all of his sons to Samuel, the prophet. And Samuel picked the first and said, oh, certainly, this has to be the king. And God said, no, Man looks on the outside, but God looks on the inside. This isn't the king. And so he kept going down the line of kids, boys, sons. He got to the last one. He said, yeah, none of these are going to be the king. He said, do you have any more sons? Oh, yeah, but he's the runt of the family. He's out in the field with the sheep. Please bring him. That's part of the story, but then we get to when he's facing Goliath, and you know, he's really about 15, 16 years old, and all the rest of these people are people that have been in wars. They're warriors. They're people who have fought, and even Goliath is just someone. He's almost like a special forces guy. He's out there saying, if you come to me and I kill you, then all of you have to serve us. And David says this, it's 1 Samuel 17, and I share this in the context of this message. I love this verse. David says to him as he's walking out to meet Goliath, says, all those gathered here will know that it's not by sword or by spear that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. Little punky kid coming out to battle against literally a giant. So I don't know what you're going to do, but I know what God's done. He's going to do it again. So he could give thanks in the midst of that. Are we able to say, God, I don't know how you're going to do this, but I'm giving you thanks beforehand because you're in charge, not me. If I were in charge, I'd run the other way. I'd stay on the sidelines. I'd be like his brothers are doing, who didn't even want him to talk. Do we give thanks in all circumstances? What issue, problem, or daily test do I need to ask God to help me give thanks to him about? Could be your loud neighbor. Sherry and I bought a new bed yesterday. It's way too expensive. It says it's got a snoring setting. I hope you can give thanks for your spouse, even if they snore. Not he, it could be either one. Do you need to give thanks for an irritating coworker, irritating clients, or people that you work with? Lord, I thank you for them because they help me to keep my job. Give thanks in all circumstances. By the way, all three of these, be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances. What was the last phrase of verse 18? For this is God's will for you. I know I've said this more than a few times in here. Some people say, well, what is God's will for me? Some people say, well, I'm done and I'm ready to go. My life's over. That's not true. As long as you're alive, God has a plan for you. And I want to say, Eugene, put that last verse, the 16, 17, and 18 up again. You say, well, I don't know what God wants me to do anymore. Right here. It may not be a big plan for your life, but it's a plan for every day. Let's read it together again. Because this is what God wants us to do today, tomorrow, each day, no matter what kind of day it is. Let's read it together. Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Let's pray together. Father God, we are thankful that you care about us so much that you give us your son, Jesus. You give us life, you give us hope, you give us peace, you You give us joy, and you change our hearts so that we can be kind to each other. Lord, we can be graceful to other people. Lord, that's a part of changing our lives to be more like Jesus. But Lord, when we seek to lift you up in our lives, it's not just lifting you up on Sunday morning during the service. It's certainly not just during the song time. Worshiping you means honoring you with our life. Each day, every day, all day, no matter what kind of day it is. So Lord, challenge us with this passage from 1 Thessalonians to be joyful always, to hold on to the joy that comes from Jesus, to pray continually, to seek you and remember your presence is right there with us. Your strength, your hope, and to be able to give thanks for both of those and so much more. To say, Lord, I don't know what's going to happen here, but I trust in you. I trust in your hope and your Son. And Lord, we also agree with you that all of those things are things you want us to do. But this is your will, your desire for us to keep seeking to do that, not just now, at the end of this hour, but in the next hour, the next day, next week, every day. Lord, help us to do that as we seek to honor you in our life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this point in time, I'm going to ask that we stand as we finish our service with hymn number 1, the first hymn in the hymnal, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Melt love. verse to you again. It's there in your notes, Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. May you trust in God and his blessings as you go from here. Thank you for coming today.
You're welcome.